everyone, Carol here at Oak House Journals, and I had an idea this morning that I thought I'd have a little bit of a play with, and I was just going to get on with it, but then I thought, well, why not turn on the camera and share it? I don't know how well it'll work, whether it will work at all, but again, it's another one of my rusted fabrics that I thought I would have a little play with. I love these two pieces, I have to say. As you can see, this one's got more orangey, rusty tones in it, but still a nice subtle grey. And this one is much, much lighter, more yellow tones. And the only orange is this little tiny dot down here. So I'm not sure which piece I'm going to play with, but I also thought that I would have a play with this paper. Now, this, I have no idea what paper this is, but as you can see, it looks like banana leaves or some sort of leaves that have been woven into paper. And you can definitely see the grid pattern of the paper. Now, I now have two pieces of this. I only had one originally because I've just tried just now to, it was joined originally like so, I think, or the other way around. Anyway, it was joined like this, and I tried ripping it in half to see how well it would rip, and it just didn't want to rip at all. So I think this isn't going to work at all for getting a natural edge. So I've got my Ranger deckle-edged chopper here to one side, and I'm just going to have a go at taking a portion off one edge of this paper to see how well it cuts, because I want to use this as my backing paper. Let me just get this done. Sorry about the noise. Oh, that wasn't too bad, was it? And actually, that has cut beautifully. I'm going to pop that piece. It's quite brittle, this paper. Sorry, I was saying I want to actually use it as a backing piece before I put it on here, which this is just tea stained paper, and it will be a journal page. So I thought that I would just use this as a backing piece for the fabric. So I now know that it cuts beautifully with my deckle edge cutter. So I'm just going to make a mark down at the bottom there and just chop another piece. As I say, I don't know which of those two pieces of fabric I'm going to use, and I am going to be embroidering, if I haven't given you enough of a clue there by lifting out that rusted fabric. Oh, I love how this cuts. I was a little bit worried that it might not cut and might shred, but no, it's cutting beautifully. And let's just, I don't want much of a border, so I need to trim off more than that. Yeah, just want a hint of a border. So this is how I tend to work. I just tend to eyeball stuff and just put a quick pencil mark rather than measure it out properly. Very lazy of me, I know, but that's just how I tend to work, really. And I'm just going to take a bit more off this side and then audition it against my piece, or offer it up against my piece to see how it goes. Now, that's fine as far as I'm concerned. That'll do nicely for a border around my piece. So I'm going to cut two pieces. I've done this piece, obviously, because when I decide which piece I'm going to use, the other piece I will still do the same sort of thing by having this as a backing to it. So let's chop another piece. Now, I'm thinking something lighter for this piece still. Let's have a look. See, I'm liking, rather than this heavy orangey colour, I'm liking this lighter colour. And let me just pop that on there. probably would have worked better with the other piece. Let me have a look. Let me just change them over. Yeah, now I'm liking this piece of backing paper better for this fabric because it's thicker and a deeper colour, certainly down this side. And I think that goes better on this piece of, or with this piece of fabric. So I'm liking that actually, and we'll go with that. I will level off this piece if I decide to use it, because it's a little bit wonky there. I'm going to keep these pieces because I think I absolutely love that on there, and I think I might couch it on there. Either couch it on with stitching going across it to hold it in place, or I might just stitch down it, but I like it, so I'm not going to waste that. Neither am I going to waste this tiny little scrap that I've got left over here. I mean, I could put that on there. Ooh, all very exciting. So I'm liking this more subtle leaf work for this piece, which is the lighter of the two pieces. So let me clear my decks again. And I am going to just trim off a portion of this one. So that I can offer that up and see what size I want. I love this new to me, deckled edge trimmer by Ranger, usual quality of Ranger. I just don't like the noise it makes. It's quite noisy. And let's just see about that. So, because I know this certainly wouldn't have... lost my pencil now. Certainly would not have ripped by hand or with a tearing ruler, just from trying the experiment of cutting the page in half, or trying to rip it in half. Just would not have worked well. But with this, it's just making such easy work of it. One side and just check that that's square, and it's not far off actually. Yep, I can live with that. And then that piece will go on top like so. Oh, I love that, I really do. And then this was the piece that I thought I would put down the side. Now it might be too much yellow, but I don't mind it. I think that's nice. So I'm back so that you can see how I've got on with my finished piece. And as you can see, so many things have changed. That strip that I was thinking I might use down this left-hand side, that went out the window. I decided that I would use a little bit of text, English text, book page down the left-hand side, but not all the way down. I put a border all the way around in stem stitch because I thought that was picking up the striations or lines in the what I'm now calling banana paper behind. I decided to work with yellows and oranges and a hint of green in this one. So these are the DMC threads that I use. No Steph Francis on this one, just my DMC threads. So as you can see, all mixtures of yellows, golds, and then I use that one as my hint of green. And the reason for that is I was just working with the colours of my piece. I added a circle of my rusted fabric behind here, and as you can see, I've just put a line of stitching round it. So instead of gathering that up into a Suffolk puff, I just used it left as is on my page, quite like that. And it's not completely affixed to my page because I wanted a gentle undulation. I wanted roughness and movement in this corner. So I've gone with delicate stitching, or I hope what looks like delicate stitching, down the side, left-hand side there. And that is feather stitch. And I just put some lazy daisy, little tiny lazy daisy stitches in the joints. I've gone with some French knots here in the same threads to keep the colour match all together. And because there was just a hint, tiniest hint of green in the fabric, that's why I chose the single strand of green thread. So there's a Suffolk puff here. I've done some very, very loose French knots in the centre of it. And then this cascade of twisted stitching here. These are bullion tendrils. So instead of doing a tight bullion knot, you completely overwrap the main stitch thread so that you've got much more than would fill the area that you would normally make your bullion knot, and to keep it tight. And it gives you these tendrils. And then down here, instead of just snipping off my end, I just let my edges of my last piece of thread just fray, and I've couched it down really with a couple of little stitches just to hold it in place. So for those bullion tendrils, I used this. These are tulip long stroke regular bullion knot needles, and they have a big eye. So if I take one out, you can see what they look like. They're quite long, they have a big eye, which makes it easier to thread. And because they're so long, you can get quite a few wraps on here, although I did work along my needle and then off the end, because these are round about 120 up to 150 wraps, so quite a lot to pull through. But if you do them loose enough, they work really well. And I wanted these bullion tendrils can be worked a lot tighter even with that many wraps, but I wanted to keep mine very, very loose because I wanted it to kind of have a very rough look to this bottom corner. If I show you here on this is a little practice reminder hoop that I always have to one side of me. So you can see here I was reminding myself of feather stitch and what it would look like with a couple of threads, a little bit of I think these are called pearl knots, I think they're called. And then these are drizzle stitch. These are what bullion knots should look like if they're tight and done to the correct size. And then again, here are some of those drizzle stitches in pink. And then here, as you can see, I was almost playing with my idea for down in this corner. These are bullion tendrils, but I've done them a lot tighter than I did down here in terms of how I wrap them. So you can get different effects, obviously, by how tightly you wrap or not. So that's my finished piece, everybody. I hope you like it. It looks a little bit bumpy there where I've glued it onto my book page. But I'm quite pleased how she came out. The other piece, I'm still working on it, as you can see. It's very scrunched. I was, again, doing stem stitch border all the way around on this one. I did put a couple of little tiny strips of the banana paper actually onto my fabric, and I will stitch over the top of those. I am planning to do more or less the same sort of layout with this one, working with the same colours, but I definitely want to do drizzle stitch on this one rather than the bullion tendrils. So I'll come back at a later stage and show you that one, but that's where I'm leaving it today for you. So as always, everybody, thank you so much for watching and take care. Have a great weekend. Bye bye now.